Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the mayor of Fairlawn, John Cosgrove.
Please pardon my back over here, but good morning to everyone and welcome to Fairlawn. I'd like to welcome you all here today to this, where we're going to talk about Governor Christie's proposed sweeping reform on how we're going to fund public schools in New Jersey, the fairness formula. This will result in large savings for many of people in New Jersey and especially those in the borough of Fairlawn. It is my distinct honor and privilege to introduce and welcome back to Fairlawn the Honorable Governor of the State of New Jersey, Chris Christie.
All right, please be seated. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. Appreciate it very much. It's good to be back in Fairlawn. I want to thank the mayor, all the elected officials who are here, members of the legislature. Want to congratulate the new Bergen County Republican Chairman, Assemblyman DiGaetano. Thank you for being here. Congratulations to you. And we have a lot to talk about this morning. But let me start off by saying that this is an issue, the way we fund schools, that we have been kind of tinkering around the edges on for decades, for almost as long as I can remember. And I've lived here my whole life. But the biggest complaint now that I've been governor nearly 7 years that I continue to hear from folks is always about property taxes, always. And it doesn't matter how young or old you are. It doesn't matter whether you live here in Bergen County or whether you live down in Cape May County. It doesn't matter whether or not you've just bought your first home or you're living in the home that you've lived in for 40 years. The complaint is always the same. And we've done an extraordinary amount to control the rate of growth of property taxes. Before I became governor, the 10 years before I became governor, property taxes went up 70% in New Jersey in 10 years. And in the last 6 years, property taxes have gone up 12%. So we've slowed down the rate of growth significantly through some of the reforms we've made. But what I hear from people all the time, whether it's when I'm out traveling around the state or whether it's on my radio show once a month, is folks say to me, yeah, but when are they going to go down? Like, we're glad they're not going up as fast, but they're still going up. And how can they go down? And there's really only one way to do it. The fact is that we could do some other reforms that I think we should do, civil service reform, to give mayors like Mayor Cosgrove the opportunity to be able to manage Fairlawn and other towns in a way that will give them much more flexibility. But again, I don't think that those reforms by themselves will make it go down. Here's what's happening. What's happening is that over the last 30 years, the state has pumped billions and billions of dollars into school aid, but that the overwhelming amount of that money has gone to just 30 school districts in the state, by order of the New Jersey Supreme Court. What we've seen over the course of the last 30 years is that more money has gone to 30 districts by over $10 billion than has gone to the other 550-some districts. Think about that. About $98 billion we've sent of our tax money to 30 school districts in the state. And all of the rest of the school districts in the state, including Fairlawn, have gotten a little over $85 billion. And that's an extraordinary thing. Now, the whole idea of that at the start was that, well, those school districts, mostly located in poor urban areas, didn't have the property tax base to be able to fund their schools in the appropriate way. And so the idea was they wanted to set up so that it would be even, it would be equalized. Well, what's happened? What's happened is that we've gone completely over in the other direction. It's not equalized. You're getting shafted every year, over and over again. And if you want great schools in Fairlawn, which you do, then what you have to do is dig deeper into your pocket on property taxes to be able to fund that. And I'm going to go through some numbers with you today. I'm going to try not to give you too many, but there's some that are just too important not to talk about. And understand why I finally concluded that there's no other way to do this but to go to full equalized funding for every kid in this state. See, because I don't think that a child in Fairlawn is any less valuable than a child in Newark. A child in Teaneck is no less valuable than a child who is sitting in Patterson. Yet we have put much, much more money into those school systems. And by the way, here's the kicker on it. They're failing. They've generally done significantly worse than kids here in Fairlawn or in other school districts all across the state. So let's talk about some of the numbers specifically. Here in Fairlawn, your graduation rate is nearly 95%. So nearly 95% of the students who go to the public schools in Fairlawn graduate from high school on time. It's a great rate. It's over the state average. And it shows that here in Fairlawn, folks are doing a great job in educating the kids. You spent about $20,000 per pupil in 2015. That's over the state average also. State average is about $17,500 a pupil. You all have spent over $20,000, $20,031 in 2015. And you have an average tax bill, property taxes, of $10,013 in Fairlawn. Now, I want you to understand, and I'm sure you, when you, you know, have you gotten your tax bills already? All right, okay, so you look at the breakdown like I do. 62% of the average tax bill are for school taxes. 62%. So, you know, Mayor Cosgrove, unfortunately, has to be the guy to send out the property tax bills. And everybody looks at the mayor and goes, what the hell is going on with the property tax bills, right? Except that 62% of it is out of his control at the school board. There's another percentage of it that goes to the county that's in the control of the county executive and the freeholders. And a very, very small amount of it is actually directly in the control of the mayor. 62%. Why is 62% of your money going to schools? Well, here's why. Under the current funding formula, you only get about $2,900 per pupil from the state. $2,900 per pupil. You're paying $20,000 per kid to educate them, and the state's only picking up less than $3,000 of that cost. That means all of the rest of that money must come from you, from property tax. This is a little bit of federal funding in there, but a very small amount for a place like Fairlawn. Almost all the rest of it, almost the rest of the $17,000 per pupil per year has to come from you. Now, in contrast, let's look at Asbury Park. Let's forget Newark and Patterson and the ones that are near us. Let's go a little further south down Asbury Park. Like I said, you have almost a 95% graduation rate in Fairlawn. The graduation rate this past year that we have stats for, 2014, for Asbury Park was 66%. Only two-thirds of the kids that go to Asbury Park High School graduate. How much are they spending per pupil per year? You're spending $20,031. They're spending $33,600 per pupil per year, compared to your $20,000, and they're getting a graduation rate that is nearly 30% less than the graduation rate you're getting. You're paying 62% of your property taxes are going to school taxes. What percentage of their taxes go to schools? 25%. 25%. So why is it that they're only paying 25% of their property tax bill? And by the way, your property taxes here in Fairlawn are 10. Theirs are 5, the average bill in Asbury Park. They're half. And they pay half as less as you do, and they only pay 25% of that towards their schools. you're paying 62% of it towards your schools. Why? Because you get $2,900 per pupil per year in aid from the state. You know how much they get? $29,000. $29,000 per pupil per year from the state. Now, I got to tell you something. We've seen all this great liberal editorial and media response to me saying that's unfair. They say, oh, if he takes away aid from the urban districts, it's going to ruin them. Here's my question. How will they know? How will they know? We're paying $29,000 per pupil per year in Asbury Park. And by the way, Brookdale Community College, which is the county college in Monmouth County, tells us that of the kids that come from Asbury Park High School, now this is the 66% who actually graduate, not the 34% who don't. Of the 66% who actually graduate and go to Brookdale Community College, 95% of them need at least 1 year of remedial training to be able to get to the level to be able to take a class in the community college in Monmouth County. 95% of them. So that means we're even lying to the 66% that we give a diploma to, because it's not a real diploma. And here's the worst part for those families. Then they got to pay for it. Right? The 1 year of remedial training done gum for free. They got to pay tuition to the community college to get what they should have gotten in high school, which, by the way, we were paying $33,000 a year for. So again, I say to the liberal editorial page writers, how will you know? How will you know that somehow now we're failing people because we're giving them less money? Their solution would be to give them more. If you failed with $29,000 in state aid per pupil per year, how are you going to do with $32,000 or $33,000? Is all of a sudden that the moment when the miracle is going to happen? Our common sense tells us that that's absolutely ridiculous. So what's the fairness formula say? The fairness formula says this. Every New Jersey student should receive the same amount of aid from the state. Every student should receive the same amount of aid from the state. If we took the exact same amount of money we're spending now on our schools from the state perspective, don't cut it a dollar. Each student would get $6,599 in aid per year. What would that do here in Fairlawn, for instance? You'd get an additional $3,695 per student per year. Overall, Fairlawn would get $32 million in state aid, which would be an increase of 814% over what you get now. And because we have the 2% property tax cap in place, that money would have to go for property tax reduction. They couldn't spend more than 2% more a year because of the cap. So what would that mean for your property taxes? For the average resident of Fairlawn, not the biggest house with the most property, not the smallest house with the least property, the average person in Fairlawn would see their property taxes go down $2,223 per year. I mean, it just seems to me that we've failed under these other systems, and the system that works best in this country is competition. And if these urban school districts understood now, they had to compete. They had to compete and produce for those families and not continue to get more and more money every year, whether they succeed or they fail. We'd see more charter schools. And by the way, we have doubled the number of charter school seats in the state since I've been governor. And despite that, in Newark today, just in Newark alone, you have 5,000 families on waiting lists for charter schools. 5,000. Now, why is that? Is it because their neighborhood school is so great, but they just want to try something different? No, it's because their neighborhood school is awful, and it's failing their families. And they want something different. They want something better. And We're not forcing that to happen because we just continue to spoon feed these folks in these urban school districts, the administrators, the principals, the teachers. You know, it's, they're failing. It's not the kids that are failing. They're failing the kids. Because let me tell you this. You look at what the achievement is for charter schools in Newark, it is extraordinary. In the 90% graduation rate. Same kids. I'll tell you one example that's the most stark example. There was a public elementary school in Newark that was doing so badly that they were going to close it. And the school superintendent said, instead of closing it, I'm going to go to a charter school company that's already doing work in the city of Newark and ask them if they will just take over the school. So the only things that changed was the management of the school and the teachers they employed. All the kids were the same from 1 year to the next. In 1 year, this was the difference. In the year that it was being run by the Newark Public School District, the kids were 30% below the state average on math and 35% below the state average in reading. 1 year later, same kids were 20% over the state average in math and 15% over the state average in reading. Now, they talk all the time about charter schools. The teachers' union says, oh, they skim the cream from the top, they take the best kids, all of which is a lie because it's a lottery. So unless they're like rigging all the balls in the barrel, which I don't think is going on, they don't know who the best kids and the worst kids are. They take kids purely based on a lottery system that's required by state law. But let's put that aside. This is a school of exactly the same students, except they're being taught by different teachers, and the school is being run by a different principal. And I've gone to that school. Let me tell you what they do 3 days a week. These elementary school students, they start their day by running into the gym in different groups. They all have flags. And I was looking at the flags. I go, what are the flags? There's one flag that's the school flag of Harvard. There's another flag that's the school flag of Princeton. There's another one that's Rutgers. There's another one that's NYU. There's another one that's the College of New Jersey. There's another one that's Penn. And each of the kids are divided equally into those groups. They come in, and the principal stands in the middle of the gym and picks kids out randomly and gives them math problems to do in their head while they're sitting there, and they have to respond in front of their classmates. This was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. These kids were right every time. And they're enthusiastic. And what are they thinking about? And each one of them, one of the kids gets to dress up as the mascot of that particular school and whatever group they're in. So there's a Scarlet Knight running around, and there's a Princeton Tiger running around. And they're thinking and teaching these kids from the time they're in elementary school that this is what your potential is. Your potential is not only to go to college, and that's the expectation, but it is to go to some of the best colleges in the country. And that inspires those kids, and you can see it. These are kids who get a longer school day and a longer school year because they need it. And yet we can't do any of that under the current system despite all the money that we're paying. It's obscene. And it's got to stop. And the only way we're going to stop it is to stop spending all this money. For 30 years, these 31 Abbott districts have been overfunded at the expense of the districts just like here in Fairlawn. And by the way, it's your money that they're spending. We spend the third most per nation on K-12 education, third most in the nation per pupil. This fiscal year, for the budget we just approved, we're spending $13.3 billion just at the state level on K-12 education, $13.3 billion. That doesn't count the money that's paid in local property taxes. Now, $9 billion of that goes in direct aid. The rest of it, by the way, is debt service and pension and health benefit payments for teachers. And you're going to be hearing a lot about that over the course of the next couple of weeks, potentially, that these poor teachers are not getting what they truly deserve. I love public school teachers. I was educated in the public schools in New Jersey. I graduated from a public high school in New Jersey. But let me tell you something. There's no way that in any profession other than that one in the world, you get a job for life after 3 years. Because you get tenure after 3 years, you get a job for life. And then after 20 years, you get pension and health benefits for life. I would love to see a show of hands of all the people in this room who after 3 years had their boss come and tell them, you got a job for the rest of your life, no matter how you perform. And by the way, if you hang in there for 20, we're going to give you a pension for the rest of your life and health care for the rest of your life. Who's got that in this room? Raise them up. Nobody. Well, here's the news, everybody. Of the $13 billion that we're spending, $3.25 billion goes to just pay for the pensions and the health benefits of retired teachers. Not the ones who are teaching your kids right now. That's just for the retired ones. Just for the retired ones. So $9 billion goes in direct state aid. Of the $9 billion, $5.1 billion goes to those 31 districts. And $4 billion goes to the other 546 districts. That's this year. That means 58% of the aid of the state goes to 5% of the school districts. I'm going to stop giving you all these numbers because your heads are going to be spinning. But think about that. 58% of the aid goes to 5% of the districts. 42% of the aid goes to 95%. And that is the system that your senator from this town in this district is laying his body on the ground to defend. He wants to defend a system, Bob Gordon wants to defend a system that has 58% of the aid going to 5% of the school districts. And here's a clue. None of those 5% are in his legislative district. Why? Because he is an absolute slave to the teachers' union. He didn't care about you. He cares about the teachers' union who will write him a check for his campaign. He cares about the teachers' union who he is deathly afraid will use their money to defeat him. And since the title senator is more important to Bob Gordon than actually doing something that helps his constituents, that's what he's going to do. And you say, well, how much money could the teachers' union possibly have, Governor? Why is he so scared? Let me tell you how much they have. Do you know that every person employed by the school system in the public school system in this state is required by state law to join the New Jersey Education Association, and that those dues every year are $731 per member, and they are taken directly out of their paycheck and wire transferred to the teachers union? How many members does the teachers union have in New Jersey? 200,000 members. So do the math. $731 times 200,000 members, it's over $140 million a year. And they don't contribute a nickel to teacher salaries, teacher pension, or teacher health care. It's $140 million slush fund. $140 million slush fund to benefit their friends and to intimidate their enemies. So if you say, well, I see Bob Gordon around town. He seems like a heck of a nice guy. And Governor, how could you say all these awful things about Bob Gordon? Because he's from Fairlawn. He seems like a good guy. And yeah, he's a Democrat, but what the heck? We got plenty of Democrats around New Jersey, and we don't hold that against them. So no. He is a nice guy, but he is a timid and frightened guy. Because he knows if they open up that $140 million bank account against him, and they start mailing to you every week and phone calling you and putting it on TV, poor Bob Gordon will no longer be Senator Bob Gordon. He'll be former Senator Bob Gordon. And for those guys, the title means everything. Everything. So you say to yourself, how could it be that our senator would support this and oppose, because he's come out and opposed my plan, So think about what he's opposing. He's opposing giving you a $2,200 reduction in your property taxes. He's opposing your kids getting a fair amount of money from the state. He is opposing it. How could he possibly oppose it? Because if I were you sitting there, not involved in politics every day, having your own lives to run and your own families to care for and your own jobs to take care of, you'd say to yourself, well, I don't follow this stuff that closely. It doesn't make any sense that a guy who represents us could actually be opposed to this. So that's why I have to give you the other part of the explanation. He's more scared of them than he is of you. He cares more about what they think than what you think. It's just the facts of politics, everybody. And when you're a second-term governor who never has to run again, you are liberated, man. You are liberated. Statewide graduation rate is 90%. 90%. You here in Fairlawn are 95%. I told you were above the statewide average. 27 of the 31 districts that get all this money are below the statewide average in graduation. 27 of the 31 are below the state average in graduation rate. I mean, how much more evidence do you need that this system does not work? Yet you've got folks who are defending this with their lives. And who is it? It's the Democrats in the legislature. Because I'll tell you, I'm looking at three different legislators sitting right in front of me, and I know that tomorrow they would change the system. Tomorrow they would vote to change the system. Senator Cardinale has been yelling for decades about how ridiculous this system is and yelling into the wind because we've had a Supreme Court that somehow thinks that seven lawyers in black robes know how to run an education system better. I don't understand how that is. I mean, I am a recovering lawyer, I have to admit that, but I haven't done it for years, so I am in recovery and continuing to feel good about it. One last thing before I take your questions. Senator Sweeney, the Senate president, has put out a plan, because I came out with a plan, and you know he had to put some meat on a competing plan, because if I've got one, he's got to have one. Right? Here's his plan. I love this plan. He wants to set up a commission of four people to study school funding for a year. That's what you need, right? Because we've been watching this train wreck for 30 years. So let's get four politicians together to study this for a year. Now, I think that's interesting, too, because if we study it for a year, what does that take it past? The next gubernatorial election. Because heaven knows we wouldn't want to discuss this in a gubernatorial election, especially if you're Steve Sweeney and you're thinking about running for governor. Heck, you don't want to talk about this. So let's hand it off to somebody else. And here's what he's saying. Now remember, we're sending out $9 billion a year this year in direct aid. He's saying that we're going to look at a small amount of that money, somewhere around $500, $600 million, that will move around to other places. Because in a $9 billion problem, moving $600 million is going to solve it, isn't it? And four politicians are going to decide. Two of which I get to appoint, one of which he gets to appoint, one of which the Speaker of the Assembly gets to appoint. And why four? Isn't it likely that they could turn out to be 2-2 in terms of their approach if I appoint two of them and then two Democrats appoint one each? It would almost seem, if you were cynical, and I know those of us in New Jersey are not cynical, but never. But if you were cynical, you might think it was a system absolutely designed to come up with no solution. Two Republicans and two Democrats, politicians appointed by other politicians to solve a problem where they can't get a majority of the vote unless one of them crosses over political lines and votes for something that they don't believe in. Sounds like a plan. That's a plan to do nothing. So here's the thing. I'm not running for governor. Done it twice. 2-for-2. It's time to retire. You don't want to run again. You might actually lose. You don't want to do that, for God's sake. So you're 2-for-2. The Constitution tells me I can't run again. I'm not running. We got to fix this problem. And you deserve better than what you're getting. We've had a 30-year experiment on this funding formula, and it's wrong. It's failed. And I can tell you this, the only way it's going to change is if you get on the phone with Bob Gordon and you tell him, you don't support giving more school aid to Fairlawn, we're voting you out. See, because in the end, the teachers union can spend as much money as they want, but the only thing they're spending money to do is to influence your vote. And if you say, listen, I made my decision. You don't support this, buddy, and you're gone in 2017. You will be a former. Believe me, he'll get religion quick. Quick. He will get religion. But we need to talk about it out loud. And that's what I'm going to be doing for the next 6 months. I'm going to be coming to places like Fairlawn and telling you the exact numbers on how you're getting it stuck to you. And telling you that it's in your hands. It's in your hands to change it. Believe me, this formula comes to my desk. I'll sign it the minute it hits my desk. And we'll implement it. And we'll implement it fairly. And we'll make sure, and I'm sure the mayor will make sure, that those property tax bills go down. Because I want folks in Fairlawn who want to stay in Fairlawn to be able to afford to stay in Fairlawn. This is where you choose to live. You should be able to live here. And it shouldn't be property taxes and income taxes that you're sending to 31 school districts that prevents you from living in your home or, if you're a young person, buying your first home in the town that you want your children to be raised. And by the way, with a 95% graduation rate, lots of young families should want to come to Fairlawn and have their kids educated here because they're getting a great public education and it's giving them the opportunity to go wherever it is they want to go in life. That's a good thing. It's a good thing for this town. It's a good thing for the state. And so we're going to keep talking about this stuff. And we're going to need your help to get it done because otherwise it won't work. Can't do it by myself. But I'm happy to be the agitator for this. And I know you're all surprised to hear that I might actually be an agitator on anything. But we're going to agitate on this and see what we can get going in the state. And we get people a little riled in the state. You guys can move mountains. You've done it before. So now we're going to get to the fun part of this. I'm going to stop giving a speech, and you get to ask me questions. And by the way, you can ask me questions about the fairness formula or about anything else that's on your mind. I'm happy to answer your questions on anything this morning that you have on your mind. And my only request is that raise your hand and I call on you, and we have a few guys and ladies running around here handing out microphones so that everybody here can hear you. And I can hear you, and so I can answer your question the right way. But I'm ready to take questions from anybody, so who's got them? Let's go to the gentleman all the way in the back.
Just citing your stats from a comparison of Asbury Park to Fairlawn, can you explain, I don't know if you even have an answer for this, why would it cost so much more to educate a student in one town versus another? If you're providing them the same education, it makes no sense.
No, it makes absolutely no sense. My belief is that there is enormous waste in that number, that they add more and more staff. I mean, I could just tell you that when we sent a superintendent down to the Newark School District and the Camden School District, when we took that over, do you know that in the Camden School District, they've gotten rid of, because of a state appointed by me, superintendent, they have gotten rid of two-thirds of the central office staff that existed when we took it over. Two-thirds. And let me tell you something. Nobody misses them. Right? So I think what you're seeing in these districts is when more and more money gets poured in, everybody's aunt, uncle, niece, nephew, and cousin are getting hired into these things. It's becoming the full employment agency of Asbury Park. And you're not seeing any better result in the classroom. The other thing, too, is that the union imposes these extraordinary work rules that are more costly and which aren't producing results. But what they're doing is boosting teacher salaries, which boosts teacher pensions, and everybody's happy if you're a part of that group. There's no explanation for it. Now listen, in some of these urban areas where you have broken families or you have families that are working 3 and 4 jobs to be able to keep a roof over their head, there is less support at home for students. Well, the response to that should not be to continue to have those kids go to school from 8:30 till 2:30. It should be to have a longer school day in those districts and a longer school year in those districts. And by the way, that's what charter schools do in those urban areas. Most of those charter schools have 11-month school years. And they have longer school days so that when the school day is over, kids are be able to stay at the school, work with teachers who stay, and work to do their homework. I mean, I know with our four kids, like, if we're not all over them about their homework, and you know it too, it's like the likelihood of it getting done gets less and less. You know, I got home late the other night, and I walked into the house, and Mary Pat was sitting on the back patio, and it was dark, and she had candles lit, and I thought, hey, romantic night for me, maybe. No, wasn't it. She was reading a book. I said to her, what are you reading? And she said to me, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. I'm thinking, like, I read that a long time ago. What's she doing reading it now? So what are you doing reading it now? She goes, well, it's one of Bridget's, our youngest, summer reading books. And she said, I'm reading it while she's reading it so I can make sure that she's actually reading it. Like when she says, oh, yeah, I read 40 pages today. And I'm like, okay. Then Mary Pat, like, reads ahead. And then she says, well, what did you think about when this happened? And when Bridget gives her that blank stare, Mary Pat's like, okay, go 40 pages back, kid, because you didn't read it and you're not fooling mom. Right? I mean, parents need to be involved to that level. And if for some reason they can't be, because homes are broken or homes are overworked and the parents just literally can't be there, then we can't give up on those kids. But that's what we're doing, and we're spending a fortune giving up on them. So that's my explanation for it. I can't tell you about every nickel, but I can tell you from looking at what happened in Newark and what happened in Camden when we went in and took over, there's a lot of that going on. And plus, there's too many schools in Newark. The enrollment's declining in Newark, yet we don't close schools because it's politically unpopular to close a school in a neighborhood. Like, I'm sorry, but, you know, that's like saying, you know, in Fairlawn, that enrollment's going up and up and up and up, but we're not going to build any new schools. Well, you got to react to the market situation, right? More people in Fairlawn, you're going to need more schools. You're going to have to bite the bullet and build more schools. Less people, you should close the schools. But they don't do that either, by the way, so because it's unpopular, and God knows we wouldn't want to do anything that's unpopular. Yes, sir.
Christie, first I'd like to say that I became a big Chris Christie fan after listening to your appearances on my favorite sports talk radio show.
Oh, well, there you go.
I'm a property owner in the state of New Jersey, and I raised my three daughters in Oradell school system. And there are two things that a property owner wants. One is to lower their taxes, as you recognize, and the second is to make a lot of money on the sale of their house. And two of my three daughters have become educators, and they've moved out of state, and they're currently employed by other school systems. And I wanted to make, for the next 2 years of your governorship in this state, I wanted to make a suggestion for you to consider. And the suggestion is that in Oradell, where I lived, I considered three towns to raise my children, Tenafly, Ridgewood, and Oradell. And I eliminated Tenafly and Ridgewood because they don't teach the children how to think. They do in Oradell. That's important. And one thing I've noticed through the 80s and the 90s, last century, is that house values remain strong when school systems remain strong, as you probably know.
Yep.
And I think it's an important thing for both property owners and investors to recognize that it's reflected in the sale of the house in the town. So, again, it's just something for you to consider as these issues come up and again.
Thank you very much for what you've done. Thank you for your comment and support. Listen, there's no doubt about that. And that's why when you see a school district like Fairlawn that has a 95% graduation rate, gets good test scores, sends kids to good colleges and universities and gets them off to good jobs, people want to live here. You hear that over and over and over again. So it's not just about taxes. But my point is, we're going to spend the same amount of money anyway. It's about who gets the money and what they produce. It would be great to send another $3,900 per kid to Fairlawn because I know they're going to use the money they've got to be able to educate kids in the right way. Why are we continuing to throw money down the drain in places where they're not educating the kids in the right way? Doesn't make any sense. And so, you know, if and we've seen this, by the way, in places like Hoboken and Jersey City, which, by the way, are amongst those 31 districts. But what you're seeing now, because the school systems have improved in both Hoboken and Jersey City, is you're seeing an increase in property values in Hoboken and Jersey City. This is not like we can't fix urban property values, but we have to fix it in the way you're talking about, which is families will move someplace where they believe they can get a home of value and services from their town that gives their kids and their families an opportunity to thrive. And the school system is probably the second largest part of that behind public safety. You know, what you find in most towns are if people feel safe and they feel their kids are being well educated, those towns thrive. And if public safety goes down, then people flee. And if public education goes down, people flee. Those are the two biggest factors in any municipality in this state. If you feel safe and you feel like your kids are being well educated, those are going to be towns that have good property values because there will always be a demand for those homes. If you don't have both of those, it's a big problem. And in some of our cities, they have neither. And that's a big problem. Yes, ma'am, in the back. She's going to bring you a microphone. Right behind you. She has a microphone for you.
I want to clarify something. If every child is on your plan is going to have equal amount of money, what happens to the Down syndrome child, the Asperger's child?
That's different.
The child who has cerebral palsy? They need a hell of a lot more than
I didn't mention
other
that part.
People.
Special education students are exempted out.
I'm sorry?
Special education students are exempted out. They will get more money, and they do now. We give a special education supplement now under the formula. That would not change. I'm talking about children who do not have special needs, which are the overwhelming majority in the state. But we would not reduce the amount of money for special needs kids. In fact, it would stay the same. So if you're a special needs, no matter where you are,
okay. Well,
across
that
the state,
wasn't kind of, you know.
Yeah, I didn't cover everything. I'm sorry. I didn't cover it all. But that's why the question and answer part is really important, because there will be stuff I will forget. And I'm glad you raised it. So, no, special needs kids will continue to be supplemented with the amount of money we spend, because you're right, they need much more one-on-one attention. And different methods of teaching to have them reach their full potential. And so we will continue to do that. That's exempted out of this. This is for every school child who is not classified as a special needs kid. Yes, ma'am, right here.
I have three things that are bothering.
All right, here we go. Hey, wait, when you do all three, get the microphone so we can hear all three of them.
Oh, everybody's. If it is.
Although I think I would have heard her without them. But
I think you would, too. I've always had a loud voice.
Me too.
Yes, I know. And I was reached out.
Good.
Okay. I wasn't actually a supporter of yours at the beginning. But when you put the state limit for administrators in the school system that they couldn't earn more than you at $175,000, I really admired that. And I became a Christie supporter.
Good, all right.
I'm not anymore.
Well, listen.
I'm honest, too.
Life varies. What can you do?
Yeah.
At least I had a moment with you, and that's good.
Yes, you did.
All right, good.
One thing that really disturbed me was, I believe it was last year, three of your top administrators who were making a nice amount of money were granted a 25% increase in their salaries. And that bothered me because they were making so much already, and we've had to cut several programs in the state to fund their raises, and that bothered me. For instance, in Patterson now, I'm very upset that the pools have to close because they don't have enough money to keep them open. And now, what are these children going to do? Yeah. They're going to stand on street corners and get in trouble, and I think that's part of the state problem.
All right. Do you want me to do one at a time, or you want to get all three out, then I do all three? Which do you prefer?
I'll do all three.
Yeah, I figured. All right, go ahead.
Second, I know you're against the gas tax increase.
Kind of.
Yeah. What bothers me about that is if you increase the gas tax, the 23 cents a gallon, you're hurting the average person. And then you're talking about cutting certain taxes to relieve some of that pain, but you're not relieving it for me. You're relieving it for very wealthy people.
No, not true, but we'll get to it, but that's not right.
You're going to cut the inheritance tax, which would never bother me.
Right. Well, you may not think it would bother you, I'm not going to let this one go. My proposal was to cut the sales tax. You pay the sales tax?
Yes, but not on big items. I'm not going out to buy a Rolls Royce.
I understand that. But the fact is that you pay sales tax on a majority of your purchases in this state. That's not just for the rich. Everybody in this room who does make purchases in this state pays a 7% sales tax. And if we reduce that sales tax from 7% to 6%, that is affecting you in a direct way. Now, the reason I'm opposed to what they're doing on the gas tax now is for the very reason you said it. Like, I think that it's wrong for New Jersey to be one of only two states in the country that has both an estate tax and an inheritance tax. We're one of only two states, us and Maryland. That's it. Other states don't do this. So should we reduce that? I think we should, because I think it'll help us maintain more people staying in the state. I've got plenty of people who come to me and say, it's not that I can't afford to live here, I can't afford to die here. But my plan said, because they came forward with a plan that was just about estate and inheritance taxes and some other smaller tax reductions, earned income tax credit for the poor, a few other things. What I said to them was, I'm not going to raise a tax like the gas tax that everybody pays unless I'm going to cut a tax that everybody pays too. And everybody pays the sales tax. And so I'm not advocating just tax cuts for the wealthy. That's the Democrats who are doing that. I'm advocating for a broad-based sales tax reduction from 7% to 6% to do one of the final reversals of one of the things that Corzine did when he was there, which was raise the sales tax from 6 to 7. And if you don't think that makes a difference to you, a 1% cut in the sales tax is about a $1.6 billion tax cut for people in the state. It's a lot of money, and it's not just on the big items. It's on everyday items that people pay. The reason they do it to you is because you can't keep track of it. It just adds up, right? You go to the supermarket and you're at the checkout counter. Are you looking each time at what the sales tax is that you pay, or whether you go to any of the other stores that you work in? So I'm going to have to stop you on before you get to the number three thing that gets you angry, because I'm not doing it. And they're stopping me from cutting the sales tax. And that's why I'm not doing the transportation funding right now until we get some type of broad-based tax reduction for people like you. Not just for when you die. I'd like to reduce your taxes for when you're alive.
Me too.
Good. All right, what's number three?
The third one isn't really something that's bothering me, but a question. Why do you feel that the Asbury Park and the Newark and the Patterson kids aren't doing as well as we are in Fairlawn? Do you feel that it's the teachers that are failing them, or do you think it's the students that aren't really interested?
I think that it's the system that's failing them in a bunch of ways. Now, there's no one easy answer to this, right? So I'm not going to give you an easy answer. I'm going to give you a complicated one. In our urban centers, there tends to be more family challenges as well. And that's why I gave the example of Mary Pat, sitting on the patio and reading A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, right? I mean, parents need to be involved. And any of you in this room who have raised children or are raising children now know that if you really want them to do well in school, you need to be involved. If you're not involved and your child still does well, it's a miracle. And that's great, but it's not likely to happen. So I think there are some family challenges in our urban areas that are born of broken homes and are born also of, the current economy, all across the country, where people are working multiple jobs to try to make ends meet. And it's not that they don't care, it's just literally that they're working 12 or 14 or 16 hours a day and aren't home to be able to help. So I don't want to lay this on the kids, because I think that each child is born with a certain God-given potential. Different for each child, but they each have it. It's our job to bring that potential out. And I do think teachers are failing, not all of them, but many of them. And the example of that school in Newark, where the charter school brought in new teachers and a new principal to exactly the same kids, and the test scores doubled in 1 year, should answer a lot of that question for you. I'm not ready to give up on kids in Newark and Patterson and Asbury Park. They shouldn't be given up on. Those children deserve to have a bright future. future if they're willing to work hard. Now, are there some kids who aren't willing to work hard? You bet. And I bet there's kids at Fairlawn who aren't working hard. I know there's kids in my town who aren't working hard. They don't care. You can't fix every problem, but you try to fix the ones that you can. And if we're seeing these kind of results in Fairlawn and we're not seeing them in Patterson, we have to ask why. And I do think that we need to teach those kids differently, too. If you don't have more intact families, if you do have more stress and strain where there's not people at home that are able to supplement what's going on at school, well, then you need to keep the kids at school longer. You worry about the kids in the Patterson, you know, school, the Patterson City Recreation Department who don't have the pools. Well, you know what? You know what the problem is? Is Patterson only spends 25, 27% of their money on the school system. The rest of their money they spend on their bloated city government, who should be paying for those things, but because they're so big and bloated in employment agencies, they don't pay for the things that are important. And then they want to come to the state and say, you should pay for it. Well, heck, you know, at some point, they got to be responsible inside Patterson to spend money the right way. That's why I'm for a longer school year as well, so those kids aren't on the streets standing on the corners looking to get in trouble. Keep them in school. They need it anyway. If they're graduating at a 66% rate in Asbury Park, you think it would get better if they spent two more months in school? I do. Would it get better if they got a principal and a set of teachers who were really inspired to try to make the extra effort to help those kids whose challenges may be more severe? And the lady in the back talked about special needs kids. We don't say just because they have special needs, whatever the different affliction is, that we give up on them and say, well, they can't learn. Yeah, they can. And for the parent of a special needs kid, all they want is the same thing you and I want for our kids, which is to reach their highest potential. The highest potential for a special needs kid is going to be different than the highest potential for a child who, you know, scores 95% on the AP tests. But we have an obligation to both. And in the cities, we shouldn't walk away from this. And we can't. Yeah, I don't get overtime. I don't understand that. Right? Well, listen, you know, let's go down this road with you, okay? You see what we've been trying to do in Atlantic City, okay? Where there's all kinds of waste and abuse and all kinds of fighting over what we should do or not do with the municipal government. Now, we've got stories today saying that the state is somehow delaying on this $74 million loan that Atlantic City needs in order to pay its bills by Monday, I think. We're not delaying on it. You know why we haven't executed the loan agreement? Because we've sent them the terms of the loan agreement and they don't like them. Because what we're saying is, if I'm gonna loan them $74 million of your money, I want it secured by every asset they have. So that if they don't pay it, I get to take the assets, sell them, and pay you back. Now, two things are happening in Atlantic City that you need to understand. One, they're marking up the loan agreement. You are in no position to dictate terms to me when I'm giving you $74 million to stay alive. My job is to protect the interests of the people who are giving them that $74 million, and that's all the people in the rest of the state. Secondly, now they're saying we need an extension on the 150 days that we gave them in order for them to come up with a plan to manage themselves responsibly. Now, 150 days was good enough a few months ago. Now, all of a sudden, they need more time, which I said at the time. When I agreed to the 150 days, which I didn't want to do, I said, and I will bet you that they will not come up with a plan within 150 days. Now, we're in August next week. They're now asking for an extension of time. Let me make it really clear to all of you. No chance they're getting an extension of time, right? But I'd be willing to bet you that Democrats in the legislature are going to come back and say, well, they're trying really hard. Maybe you should just give them a little more time, Governor, and give them the money. I'm not doing it. And by the way, if they don't sign the loan agreement that I've given them, they're not getting the money. And if that means they go bankrupt, they go bankrupt. That's their choice. But I'm tired of this. And so you read about Patterson and Mayor Torres, I didn't read this story, but it wouldn't surprise me, getting overtime payments. I don't understand. You're an elected official. You get overtime? Elected official, like, that's your job to be on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Not like overtime. Mary Pat's going to be really angry. If she found out for the last 7 years I was eligible for overtime and wasn't putting in for it. Like the four different vacations that got canceled and the, she's really going to be ticked. So I would, please keep that to yourself. Because hey, I don't want to go home and forget candles. I don't know what will be happening when I get home if they find out I could have overtime. But this is the stuff that angers people and why I'm fighting the way I am about Atlantic City. Because it's your money. I loaned them $74 million, not like it's mine. I'm the steward for your money. So I've set out requirements for the loan, which I am authorized to do by the legislature. They sent it back all marked up. We want to change this. We want to change. Well, excuse me. You're asking for $74 million to stay alive. You should just say, where do I sign? Thank you, sir. Like a bank. Exactly right. You mark up your loan documents with the bank? I never did. They said, like, here's the deal, man. Here's the interest rate. Here's how you have to pay back. Here's what we need to secure it. You know, I'd really not like to secure this loan with my home. I'd like to secure it with my car. They said, well, your car's only worth $20,000 and your home's worth a lot more. Well, I just don't feel good about that. So would you give me this big loan with less security? It's crazy, right? So you think you're angry. You should do this job for a couple of years. You'd know anger. You would know anger then. And by the way, on that first point that you made, to make sure I'm not avoiding it, the budget that I spend on the salaries of my staff is lower today than it was in my first year. And it is significantly lower than the Governor Corzine's last year. I may reapportion the money differently, but sometimes what I do in those three raises was I merged jobs. So yeah, they got a raise of 25%, but we got rid of 100% of somebody else's salary and then gave them a quarter of that salary to do two jobs. So if you look at the overall amount that we spend in the governor's office on salaries for my staff, it is less today than it was in my first year, and it's less today than it was when I took over for Governor Corzine. So I'm pretty content with that. And you want to go over the books, come on down to Trenton. We'll go through it with you so you can see. Let me turn back this way. No? So we'll go to you. I'll give you mine.
I thanked you and shook your hand. The last time I saw you, when we got our charter school approved for the Teaneck-Englewood area. And unfortunately, the local planning board was able to delay our zoning, and even though it should have been a sure thing. And so we were missed our deadline. And so it seemed like the winds of the willpower to have charter schools outside of urban districts, whatever that means, is possibly the reason we weren't able to continue, even though a lot of other schools in urban areas were able to continue. Even though they missed their deadlines, we're given a planning year and so forth. So is this something that we can hopefully see some change in the future? Or, I mean, I would love it to be in our specific case, but in general, what is your posture on outside of urban area charter schools?
Listen, I've approved them. And Wells is going to give you his card, so you can send me all the specifics by email after the meeting, and I'll sit with the education commissioner and get some direct answers for you on it. Be happy to do that. But I've approved charter schools outside of urban areas, but for specific needs. Right, so I remember your school, and it is serving a specific kind of need. I don't want to put charter schools in a whole bunch of suburban districts that don't really need them. If you got a 95% graduation rate in Fairlawn, I don't need to put a charter school in Fairlawn. Kids are getting a really good education, and they're doing very well, and there's no reason for me to add a charter school there. But there are instances, like in yours, where I have approved some for outside of urban districts. But my focus has been on urban districts because that's where families are suffering the most, because they don't have the ability to send their child to a private or parochial school because they don't have the money to do so. So if you're in a failing public school in an urban district, you have no choice but to continue to send your child to that failing school. Charter schools gives you an option to do something else. I have approved them outside urban districts. I'll continue to approve them outside urban districts. But I have approved many more in urban districts than in suburban districts because I think the need is much greater there. But we'll look at your specific one. I'm not familiar with what happened with that, but Wells will give you his card. You email the stuff to him. He'll get it to me, and I'll go through it with the education commissioner. And then we'll get back to you. Give us your contact information, and we'll get back to you with specific answers. No problem. Thank you. Yes, sir, right there, black shirt.
Governor, I'm fully in support of the fairness formula, but the reduction in the urban areas seems to me to be drastic.
It is.
And I wonder if that couldn't be phased in.
It will be.
Thank you.
It will be phased in, yeah. You can't cut aid to a particular district by 45 or 50% in 1 year because it would just be too drastic. We'd phase it in over 3 years. And it gives them the opportunity to plan and to make their changes. And so your $2,200, the good news is, though, that means your $2,200 reduction would come to you over 3 years. So every year you'd see a little bit more and a little bit more. While we're reducing that money there, we're increasing your money. So, yeah, you cannot do this in one fell swoop. If you do it like that, it's irresponsible. It will be too difficult for them to make all those changes that quickly. It would be very disruptive. But those changes have to be made. So we'd give them a three-year phase-in on it, and that's the way we would do it. Other questions? Yes, ma'am. They're coming to you with one. Or you could just give it to this lady and she'll say it and everybody will hear it. It'll be great.
A couple of things. I have a concern about the reduction in the communities that you're talking about because we know that the best way to reduce poverty in a community generationally is to increase high school graduation rates. Right. And my concern is if we drop them without some innovative ideas like you've been talking about, you know, extending the school day and the school year, we're just increasing the pipeline from the cradle to the prisons, and we're going to end up spending more in prisons than in schools. And so I do have a concern about that. So I have two ideas that I just want to know what your response is to them. Number one, publicly funded preschool so that the kids entering schools in those districts are better prepared. And number two, parenting education, such as funding through Medicaid, so that the parents see that their role isn't just parent, but their parents as teachers, which is an evidence-based program. And there's many others as well.
Sure. Two things. First, on the publicly funded preschool, we already have that in those 31 districts. In those 31 districts, we have publicly funded preschool for 3- and 4-year-olds. And so in the at-risk districts, we've done that. Now, what they want us to do is fund preschool throughout the entire state, which the cost of that would be extraordinary. But we do it already in those districts. Secondly, you know, the parental education, we've expanded Medicaid in the state under my leadership for the very reasons you're talking about. I'll look at that particular program. I know that they do that in a lot of the charter schools, not only here in New Jersey, but around the country. Particularly the Harlem Children's Zone has had an extraordinary program that they've come here and advocated for and that we've used now in a couple of cities, including Patterson being one of them, where you start at birth with the parents coming to these charter schools when they have an infant saying, here are the things you're going to need to do and learn yourself to become a part of your child's education. And we're doing pilot programs like that in Patterson and a couple of other of the urban districts in the state. I'm not sure about the Medicaid funding for that, and I'll have to look into it. Sure. We'll also give you his business card. Share the comments directly with me so I can make sure that I get it to the appropriate person for us. Okay. Great. And let me say one other thing about the prison stuff since you brought it up. There's been a greater reduction in prison population during my 7 years as governor than in any governor in history. We have reformed the criminal justice system in this state in ways that they're talking about in Washington, D.C., but not getting done. For instance, we've now changed it so that for people who are in on nonviolent crimes, who the only reason they're in prison is because they can't make $100 bail. And so they sit in prison, and we pay for them to be in prison. We've ended that system. And we're releasing people with supervision with bail reform now. Secondly, though, we've also said that for people who commit violent crimes, we're now giving judges the discretion to keep them in jail prior to trial. Because what we've seen over time is that the jail cells are filling with kind of petty, nonviolent drug offenders. And because our state constitution used to require that you must issue bail to someone of some amount, judges were not allowed to keep the really violent sociopaths in jail prior to it. Secondly, we've done more on drug rehabilitation than any administration in history. And we are now going to be opening by this January the first drug rehabilitation prison in the state prison system. And so every person in the state prison system who has a verified drug or alcohol addiction problem will spend the last 6 months to a year of their sentence in this prison getting certified drug and alcohol rehabilitation therapy before they leave because of the very reason you're talking about. If we send people who are drug addicted into prison, and we know that drugs get smuggled into prison, despite the best efforts of the corrections department, it happens. And then they come out drug addicted. Why do we expect that they won't go right back to committing crimes in order to support their addiction? It's an illness. It is an illness. It is a disease that we have, but we have the tools to be able to help most people get over that illness or disease, but we're not doing it. And so I'm proud of the fact that we've now been able to close a state prison on my watch, not build any new ones, but close one. And we're taking that closed prison and turning it into a rehabilitation prison. That's because we've reduced it at the state and county level. And what we're spending on corrections today is significantly less than what we spent when I became governor. And we're no less safe. The crime rates are down from when I began as governor. So you can do this in a smart way and address some of the problems that you're talking about on the systemic level, but then also deal with them at the beginning of life as well so that by the time they get to 16, 17, 18 years old, they're not so lost that their only option is a life of crime and then ultimately significant stints in prison that we all pay for. Remember, we pay twice as much. It costs about $24,000 a year to give someone a full year of drug and alcohol rehabilitation. We pay $49,000 a year to house a prisoner. So it just, even if you're heartless and you just look at the numbers, it makes sense to spend $24,000 to help someone try to rehabilitate their drug and alcohol addiction problems than to just throw them in prison. We're spending twice as much and they're coming back. So I'm very sympathetic to that point, and we'll look at the language you put in on the 1115 waiver and see whether we can be supportive or not. Yes, sir. Wells got one right behind you. He's got the microphone for you right behind you.
I agree with your fairness formula. I also like your tax plan with the gas thing. My question is how come we can't get more conservative representation on the Supreme Court? How come you let Sweeney bully you?
Oh,
why
come on.
Why can't we win that?
First off, the Supreme Court today is significantly more conservative than it was the day I walked in. Ann Patterson is on the Supreme Court, significant conservative. Lee Solomon's on the Supreme Court, Republican conservative. Faustino Fernandez-Vina on the Supreme Court, conservative Republican. And so you're saying to me, I got three conservatives on when we had one when I got there. And you're saying, why didn't you get the fourth? Well, I nominated five different people for that fourth spot, and the Democrats would not confirm any of them. Now, at some point, you just got to say to yourself, like, am I going to allow the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, who's a Democrat, to continue to appoint who that seventh person is going to be? Because when that seat's open, he gets to choose. And the list of people who he's put on there have been amongst the most liberal judges at the appellate division. So, you know, if I got three out of the four things that I want with a Democrat Senate, if that's getting bullied, I'm doing pretty well. I'm getting three out of four. And I would have loved to have gotten the fourth. But the simple fact of the matter is that they do not have any legal obligation to consider my nominees. No. And they just, I mean, I nominated five different people. They turned down two of them, and they didn't give hearings to three others. So this was not subtle. The Democrats in this state decided that even though you elected me twice with me saying that I was going to appoint conservatives to the Supreme Court, that your voice didn't matter. And that they wanted to continue to have more Democrats than Republicans on the Supreme Court. Now, right now, we have three Republicans, three Democrats, and one independent. That's where the court is now. I wanted it to be four Republicans, two Democrats, and one independent. But when I came in, there was really two people who said they were Republicans. There was really one Republican on the court when I got here. So I think the court's significantly better, and I think you're going to see two decisions already just in the last year where the union sued to force me to do things to fund their exorbitant pensions or to give them COLAs, cost of living adjustments, when we don't have the money for it. The justices that I appointed to the Supreme Court supported our position, and protected the taxpayers by not having that happen. That would not have happened before I was governor. They would have sided with the unions. And so look at the decisions, and there'll be more to come that'll show you that we've made the Supreme Court significantly more conservative than it was when I became governor.
And one last follow-up question. It's on kind of like gun control.
Just hold up to you.
My follow-up question is on like gun control. How come the Supreme Court won't hear some of the, like the NJ Second Amendment cases that they have pending? Why are they kicking that back? I think it would be beneficial to both sides.
Well, listen, they may wind up hearing some of these that are actually in suit right now because of some of the things that I've done to make it easier for law-abiding citizens to obtain firearms in the state. That the legislature is pushing back on me on that. For people who have had no criminal intent at all, they were just traveling through our state. You've read about these cases. And they get pulled over for some other traffic infraction, and they tell people, well, I'm licensed to own a firearm in Pennsylvania or North Carolina or Colorado, and I'm driving through the state. You should know I have a firearm in the car, and they get arrested in New Jersey, even though they own it legally someplace else. I've pardoned every one of those people. They have no criminal record, and they have no history of violence, and they legally own their firearm in the state where they live, and all they're doing is driving through our state. I've pardoned those people. But again, if we continue to elect liberals like Bob Gordon to the legislature and his running mates, if that's who you continue to elect, these are the policies you're going to get. Because the governor's not an emperor, as much as I might like to be. I'm not. And so I don't get to make these things and change them by fiat. And the fact is that I've had to endure for 7 years a Democratic legislature.
Well, I appreciate
it. I only wish that I had what Christy Whitman had. I would have used it a lot differently, I can guarantee you that.
Well, I appreciate what you've done on the gun control because people just don't understand it. I'm an RSO anyway. Because I can carry in 38 states. I can't carry in my own states. I like to go skeet and trap shooting, and it's like I got major, you know, issues to pick up a friend to drive there.
Yeah.
And it's ridiculous. I mean, I have to go from point A to point B. So,
well, it's because, listen, and you know why it is. It's because folks in this legislature like to make headlines, not make things safer. They like to make headlines. And, you know, they've beaten me up over the fact that I haven't signed some of their ridiculous bills, and I'm not going to. You know, Senator Cardinale and I talked about this when I was running for governor. One of the things he told me when I was running, he said, if you win, you know, you better be the adult supervision for some of the stuff that's going on down here. I don't want to hear efforts, well, I kind of had to go along. You know, he supported me because he knew that I would veto bills, and I vetoed more bills than any governor in the history of this state. But I have to thank the Democratic legislature for that, because if they didn't pass so many stupid bills, I wouldn't have the opportunity. I wouldn't have the opportunity to do it. But now, they're telling me I can take one more question, and that means that I'll take two. And the reason for that is, it's really twofold. One, it's that, you know, I want to remind them that I'm the boss, and I get to decide how many more questions I want to take. And secondly, it's because when you're governor, you're doing these town halls, you are the victim of the tyranny of the young. Look at all these young staff people I have around me, and they all tell me what I'm supposed to do all the different times and when I'm supposed to do it. And every once in a while, the old guys have to prove that we're still in charge. So we'll do two questions. So I'll start with the gentleman on the aisle right there, the blue shirt. Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm one of your supporters since
all right.
the beginning.
You didn't fall off the wagon like this lady,
no,
huh?
No, I never
all
fell
right.
off the wagon yet because...
We'll get you back, don't worry. Incredibly charming. I am.
You got a job that requires that you're going to, I don't know how to say it, I'm frank, piss people off and because you're going to do it. That's what they wanted you to do. That's what you're in there doing. And yep. You spoke about your wife. I have to ask you an odd question, okay?
Uh-oh.
When you drive...
Stay with me on this one, would you?
I have to go home to her, too.
All right, go ahead.
So we got a notice today that our tax freeze, that you dropped it $10,000, and what she said was we were over by $150 now, so we're not going to get the tax freeze. What she wanted to know if I asked you was, is there any way to put a notice on this is coming because if you're on a fixed income?
And I want to see that because we didn't reduce the property tax freeze in the budget.
Well, we called up the state, and they said you bounce it all over the place, and 1 year it could be 80, 1 year it could be 70, and now you dropped it and we missed it.
I don't think so, but you know, we're going to get your stuff and we're going to, you know, because I know this is going to be hard for you to believe, but every once in a while you call the state and you get a wrong answer, right? Hard to believe, but true. So I want you to give my guy all of your information, your name, phone number, email address, because I don't want you to go home without a good answer, but I don't want to give you an answer off the top of my head.
We also got an inside joke. Remember me? I'm Mr. Average Guy, radio station.
Oh, you're the guy
who called? I'm the guy that wanted to have a meeting with you in your office.
You know what? I should have remembered that. You should have led with Mr. Average Guy. I would have known exactly who you were.
You were funny. You said, no freaking way is this guy getting in my office.
That's
what you said.
That's exactly right. He called into my radio show and said, if I'm an average guy, and I'm just an average guy, tell me the truth, can I get an appointment to come to your office? And I said, absolutely not. I'd love to tell you could, but there's absolutely no chance that you're going to get an appointment. I'm sorry.
Getting back to the school thing. Does the state require school boards to send you some kind of a thing on what they spend this money on?
Sure.
As a particular, at my school, I'm always arguing with them that they've got a habit, and even the council and the town's got a habit sometimes. What I like to say is they'll take them, turn around, and public vote. They'll put a pool in before they'll fix the roof. The roof's leaking, but they'll put a pool in the backyard because there's more votes in the pool. And I was just curious. If
that lady, she's on the pool thing, too. This is becoming a trend.
If you turn around and, you know, if you
we have a certain amount of supervision over the spending, but not completely. In the end, the school board, in the instance of the educators, are the primary source of oversight. Now, if there's fraud going on or direct violations of state law, then the Attorney General's Office and the Commissioner of Education can come in and do an investigation and hold people responsible. But in the normal day-to-day operations, absent fraud or other violation of law, then typically the school boards are the main supervisors of the way that money is spent.
Okay, one last question.
Oh, and the mayor wanted me to know the average guy is not from Fairlawn.
No, he's not.
Oh, good. All right, good. Mayor wanted to make sure everybody knew that.
One more question.
All right.
Okay, this is going to be a touchy one for you.
Uh-oh.
Okay, where are you going to leave us? You got a plan when you move on?
When I move on?
Yep, because you're with my man that I'm going to vote for, and you're going to move on.
I have a plan?
What's going to happen to us?
What's going to happen to you? Well, let's talk about two things. I'm average guy. I'm moving on one way or the other, right? So the fact is that if Donald Trump's elected president in November, and if he were to offer me a position that both me and Mary Pat thought made sense for us to do, where we could really help the country, then I'd consider it. And that would mean I would leave sometime in December or so of 2016, of this year. What would happen then is I would leave you in the very able hands of the lieutenant governor, who would become the governor, and Kim would become the governor for the rest of my term, which would be about 13 months. And then she'd have to decide whether she wanted to run for governor in her own right, which I'm sure she's in the process of deciding as we speak. And if she wanted to run for governor, then you would all have a chance to keep her if you wanted to. But either way, in 17 months, I'm gone. The Constitution allows me to only run for two consecutive terms as governor. And so in 17, it's funny that you bring this up today, because I was just talking about this with my son Patrick this morning before I left to come here, because he asked me if I was going to miss the troopers. Patrick asked me this morning, he said, Dad, you know, you're going to not be governor for a whole lot longer. Are you going to miss the troopers? And so I said to him, well, are you? And he said, yeah, they're nice. And there will be a lot of adjustments and changes that we're all going to have to make. What I would tell you is, though, that my plan in the short term is to do my job as best I can, and if Donald wins in November, to listen to what he's got to say to me at the time. And there's no given that I'll definitely go. I'm not going to go for some job just because I don't need a job. I would only go if I really thought that I could do something to help make the country better. Because what Mary Pat wants me to do is actually go and make some money. I will tell you that, you know, she had her choice. I'm sure she's whispering in Donald's other ear going, don't offer him anything. Because she wants me to go out in the private sector and she wants me to make some money, which would be a responsible thing for me to do at some point, given that I've now been in public service for 15 years. Because I was 7 years as the U.S. attorney, then a year running for governor, and now 7 years as governor. So for 15 years, I've been in public life, making less money than I would make certainly in the private sector. And that's fine, not complaining about that. But I think she's looking at me going, hey, buddy, it's about time you start making a little more money. So I think, you know, that may be ultimately where I wind up. But in any event, I can't run again. And if that's the case, which it is by the Constitution, you're going to have to adjust to a new person in this role anyway come January of 2018. But you'll hear from me on that. As you know, I'm not reluctant to speak my mind. So I'll let you know about all the candidates. It'll be great to actually be, for the first time in 8 years, to be in a gubernatorial race that I'm not a candidate in, and I just get to sit on the sidelines and give them all advice about what they should be doing. And given that I won twice, maybe they should listen. So I can take one more. Yes, sir, right there. Here comes the microphone for you.
Oh, a quick question, Governor. First, I thank you very much for coming and going around the state and explaining some of this. If you notice from the questions, there is a lot of misunderstanding on it. My question is, what do you think the chances are of getting the fairness formula past Chief Justice Ravner?
Well, as I said in the response to this guy's question, first off, Chief Justice Ravner has never voted on the school funding stuff. He recused himself before because he was involved in putting this most recent school funding formula together as chief counsel for Governor Corzine in 2006. So I don't know whether the chief would even participate in this or not if it were to go before the court again. That's his call, his decisions to make about whether he recuses or he doesn't, but he has recused in the past on school funding issues. But this is a whole new court than we've had before. You know, three of the people now of the seven are people that I've appointed. And so, actually, four now of the seven are people that I've appointed, three Republicans and one Democrat. So it's a whole new court, and I don't know what they'll do. But I know that it's new people looking at it in a new way with more information. So, you know, who knows? And I think, you know, you'll see that this is going to become an issue not only for the legislature but for the courts as well. And it has to be. Because in the end, what's gone on here is scandalous. I mean, it really is. You know, to be spending all this money, I mean, it is extraordinary to me when you look at these numbers. $97 billion to 31 districts. Over the last 30 years, and $88 billion to the other 546. And if all those 31 districts were now with statewide graduation rate average at 90%, if they were all at 90%, we might say actually money well spent. And people in New Jersey are generous, and you've heard from some of the questions that we got from people here that people are legitimately concerned about the impact upon families and communities that are not their own community but are part of the state. That's part of what makes this state really great. But people also are tired of having their money wasted and not seeing results, because that's not only bad from a fiscal perspective, but it is awful for those families in those districts that are without hope. I went to a charter school in Patterson, I guess it was the week before the Republican convention, and I had a woman there who had her children in private school. And she stayed in an apartment so that she had the money to pay for a parochial school tuition. She finally decided that she really needed to buy a home and in Patterson. And so she took her kids out of parochial school and put them in this charter school. And she was a teacher. So she became a teacher in the charter school as well. And she said it was the greatest decision she ever made in her life, and that her children were getting an even better education in this charter school than they were in the parochial school. There's no reason that these children can't achieve. But the fact is that we're not demanding it. And the more you know this, I mean, let's talk about it really candidly. You know, if you give people money and don't make them earn it and don't hold people to standards, they oftentimes won't reach those standards. Because if you're going to give somebody something for nothing, a lot of people just say, hey, not bad, I'll take something for nothing. But when you have demands and competition and challenge that they have to meet in order to receive the financial support, you often have times that people will do more. They'll do more, they'll work harder, they'll strive harder. They'll come together as a community to get these things done. You know, believe me, the liberal editorial pages in this state will continue to tell you that we should just continue to send money to these districts and continue to send even more, because it would be unfair not to. So they care about what they perceive to be fairness for 31 school districts, but have no regard at all for fairness for the other 546. And their view is, you've got the money, so you should have to spend it. My view is, you have the money, you earned it. You should spend it the way you want to spend it. And stop having government tell you how much of your money we're entitled to spend in other places. And so that's what this is all about. And believe me, I've come to this conclusion only after 6 years of trying to do it other ways. And realizing finally that Democrats are not going to change this because it helps to fund employment agencies and their base. That's what it does. And, you know, and they have the teachers union who will continue to both cajole them and threaten them. And let me tell you something. Every time the teachers union is for something, put your hand on your wallet. Because all they care about is more money for their own members. Because more money for their own members means that their members are happy with them. And that's why you've got, you know, teachers union heads who make $275,000, $280,000 a year while they're also still teachers, except they're not teaching. They're just working on union business. And then they get pensions that you pay for. I mean, you know, I don't understand why more of you aren't like with pitchforks in the street over this stuff. I really don't. Because everybody who complains about taxes in the state, it goes back to the same thing over and over again. And that is the unions in this state, especially the public sector unions, getting more and more of your money to fund health benefits for them that are exorbitant. Do you know that this year alone, I pay $1 billion out of the budget just for the health benefits of retired teachers? $1 billion. Do you know they get a health care plan called NJ Direct 15, which is called by the Obama administration, not by me, a platinum health care plan? And you pay for it. You pay for it. And they get that from the day they're hired until the day they die. And before I was governor, they never paid a nickel for it. Not a nickel. Now I have them paying up to 20% of the cost of the premiums for most of them. And they thought that was the most outrageous attack on public education they'd ever seen. We're paying for 80% of it now, rather than 100. But before I became governor, you understand, you paid for 100% of platinum health coverage that you couldn't buy on the market if you wanted to. And you paid 100% of it from the day of employment till the day of death. Like, I don't know about you, but that really ticks me off. Like, you can't get that kind of health coverage. And it's above what the Obama administration says people should get in Obamacare. And you know what's going to happen now? Starting in a year and a half, we have to pay a fine to the federal government for providing health insurance at that level to our employees. You know how much it's going to be? $750 million in a fine to the federal government per year because we provide that level of health coverage to our public employees. And when I ask them to reduce it down to gold level, to gold, not to silver or bronze, to gold, they just fold their arms and say, hell no, we'll wait for you to leave. You should ask every candidate for governor next year, how are they going to pay the $750 million fine? How are they going to pay it? Because as my mom used to tell me, there's no magic money tree in the backyard. Whenever I used to ask for stuff, you know, my parents were, you know, hardworking, both worked, middle-class folks, and I'd go to the store with my mother and ask for something. She used to say to me all the time, sure, Chris, you can have that. But before you buy it, just go home, go into the backyard, and pick the money off the magic money tree, and then you can pay for it. I'm like, we don't have a money tree in the backyard. She's like, exactly. We don't. But the politicians in Trenton believe that you are the magic money tree. They believe that your pocket is their pocket. Imagine paying $750 million for nothing. For nothing. Except the privilege of paying billions of dollars in healthcare premiums. I mean, there's no logic to it. And when there's no logic to something, there's only one conclusion you can come to, and that is intimidation. And you'll see, we're going to see a lot over the next 10 or 11 days, just how intimidating this group is, and whether or not the people that are elected to the legislature, like Bob Gordon, are going to stand up for you, or are they going to stand up for their union pals? I'll end with this. I appreciate the sentiment of the regular guy about what it is I'm going to be doing or will do. I will tell you this. I am the greatest privilege of my life has been being governor for the last 7 years. And I was born in this state. I was born in Newark. Lived there till I was 5. My parents moved to Livingston and raised me and my brother and sister in Livingston. Went to the public schools. Went to the University of Delaware. Went to Seton Hall Law School. No Ivy League guy. Nobody who I think anybody looked at and said was like, you know, born into some great political family or bound to be able to do this. It's because I cared about the state where I lived and I was willing to work hard and speak my mind and do what I thought was right. And I'm going to continue to do that with the time that I have left as governor. But you should understand how much Mary Pat and I appreciate the opportunity that you've given us over the last 7 years. It has changed our life in significant ways. It's opened our children's lives up to opportunities and experiences that we'd never had otherwise. And it's been an extraordinary thing. But I am not looking to retire until January of 2018. And those people in Trenton who believe that somehow I am going to fade quietly into the night have not been watching me all that closely. I will not fade quietly into the night. I will not go along to get along. That's not who I am. And you're going to see manifestations of that. You've seen it already this year. You're going to see a lot more of it in the next few weeks. I'm fighting on the Transportation Trust Fund, not because I don't want to rebuild roads and bridges, but because I have said all along that if you're going to ask for a tax increase at the pump from people in this state, you better give them a tax cut someplace else so you don't reduce the amount of money they have to be able to spend on their families. And I don't care how much pressure they put on me, that road work is stopped and this project or that project. You know, cry me a river. My job is to represent you and your pocketbooks. And so I'll take the heat. I'm happy to take it. After 7 years of taking heat, man, doesn't even feel that hot, you know? We'll do what we need to do. I will stand up and continue to fight. And there is a luxury in not running again. So she was on the wagon, off the wagon, on the wagon, now back off or back on. You're back on. But here's the thing. I'm happy about that personally, but you never get a chance to vote for me or against me again. This is it, right? Right? So when that happens, you don't ever have to even have that lurking in the back of your mind. I'm just going to do what I think is right for the next 18 months, the way I've tried to do it for the last 6.5 years. And there'll be some people who agree with me and some people who won't. Like the regular guy said, I'll piss some people off, and other people I'll make stand up and cheer. But I'm telling you something, if you're looking to be universally loved in a job like this, you should never run, because you won't be. And if you are, then you are doing something wrong, and the price that you're going to have to pay for that over the long haul is going to come out of all your pockets. The governors who have done things like double the budget over the course of their 8 years, the governors who have raised taxes and increased spending, they all feel good at the moment. But it always feels good to spend somebody else's money and not your own. I'm happy to say that this budget, except for pension and health benefits, is $2 billion less today than the day I walked in. That means I say no over and over and over and over. And it'll make you popular to keep saying no, because every person thinks their program is the most important. I can't tell you how many times I say to people, they say, you should cut spending, Governor. It's an outrage how much this state spends. And I'm like, good, okay. So one of the programs I'm cutting is this one. They go, oh, well, that's a very good program. And I happen to actually personally benefit from that program, and so does my family, and I think it's – so there's a lot of waste other places. Stay away from that one. You've got to be willing to look people in the eye and say, no, sorry. we're going to do what's right, and we're going to reduce spending because that's what people elected me to do. So don't fear about what's going to happen to me in the next 6 months or in the next 18 months. We'll work it out. Kim's great. If I leave in the next 6 months, she'll do a great job, and she'll continue the course that we've been on because she's been part of it. And if it's 18 months from now, well, then all of you have a choice to make. You're going to elect a new governor in November 2017. And select carefully. Select carefully. Because I guarantee you something. Anybody who's making you all kinds of big promises of all the things they're going to do and all the awful, horrible things that I did they're going to correct, keep your hands on your wallet, everybody. Because they're not spending their own money, they're spending yours. That's why the fairness formula is so important. That's why we have to get it done before I leave. Because if we get it done before I leave, it's going to make it a lot harder for the next guy to reverse. If we wait for someone else to do it, you may be waiting a long time and paying even higher property taxes here in Fairlawn, despite the great job that the mayor does in controlling the part that the municipality spends. He can't control all of it. He controls the stuff that he can. And the freeholders control what they can do at the county level. But the school board, whole different story. And if they're not getting any help from the state, that's what's going to happen. So go out and talk about this. You know, when you what you got left in the summer. We got a whole another month left of the summer. Go out. I'm going to keep going out and doing this. I'll be out every week for the rest of the summer doing this and into the fall. And we may have other things that we have to talk about, too. So I will be ready to go. Thanks for your time today. I appreciate it very much.